So I had another video planned this weekend, but due to unexpected time restraints, I'm just not going to get that video done in time. So instead of last minute decided to do this one video, which quite literally everybody has been asking me to refute. I'll be honest with you guys though. Now, you know that thing that YouTubers do, even I do it, when you're about to go into a video response, and it's like, "Ooh, this was the worst video I've ever seen, it was so painful, ooh." Okay. This video, I am 100% serious. I got halfway through watching it, making notes on what I was going to say. I wanted to give up. I did not want to do it because it's just so bad. I just did not consider it worth my time. So just please understand that when we're going into this. But this is 5 reasons communism doesn't work. So, let's get into it.
You know, in a perfect society, everyone would have equal access to food, shelter, and every other form of basic resource necessary, not only for survival, but for living a good quality life. In a truly realized utopia, there would be not the smallest hint of racism, sexism, and every other form of discrimination and oppression. And at the very core of this utopian imagining of the world would be, well, communism. Or at least it would be if history had not, from time to time again, proved communism to be rather incapable in his quest for realizing an advanced and absolute egalitarian society.
Ah, the good old communism has never worked, meme. We'll get to that later, because he does bring it up again, obviously.
While communism has evolved to be a particularly complex, convoluted, and nuanced concept, both of economy and politics, almost everybody who has heard of the word has a basic, a bit simple understanding of the kind of society it imagines.
Here's the thing though, they actually don't have a basic understanding at all. Seriously, the average person today knows the same amount about communism as they do about quantum physics, and that's not even hyperbole.
Simply put, communism pushes for a world governed by absolute egalitarianism more than anything else. Communism aims to enable a global society where every member has equal access to the fruits and benefits derived from labor. Communism, most recognizably, ends in socio-political and economical equality realized through the elimination of, well, private property. And communism is the sworn enemy of capitalism. Built on the cornerstone of social equality, communism, since its inception, has always been an attractive alternative to the predominantly capitalist mode of society that is embedded in most of the modern world.
This is basically the communism means equality for everyone on everything meme, but you know, expanded on. And see, you've actually just proven the point I was making by trying to give an explanation of what communism is.
But if communism was such a noble idea, then why hasn't it replaced capitalism as the dominant force that drives global economy?
I mean, this question seems to assume that good ideas always inherently win out, but they kind of don't. I mean, especially when it's in the interests of those in power to not let those ideas win out.
If in theory communism was all about egalitarianism, then why in practice has it yielded only unstable dictatorial governments?
Again, he brings up the communism's never worked thing, but he does bring it up again later on, so I don't want to make the same point twice, so we'll just...
To arrive at answers to these questions, it is imperative that we not only define communism, but take a focused look into every nook and cranny of its crumbling establishment.
Every nook and cranny of communism. In a 13-minute video. Okay.
And as with most things with a long, complicated history, the best place to start is where it all began. London, 1848, with the publication of the quintessential Marxist text, The Communist Manifesto.
I mean, when you're talking about communism here, you're actually referring to Marxism, because of course communism existed before Marx, but whatever. The reason why that's important is because this guy kind of flip-flops between terms for socialism, Marxism, communism, just like kind of a lot in this video, to the point where you don't really even know what he's talking about, but we'll get into that later.
It was also socialism that first advocated for the state to take sole and absolute control of the forces and means of production and distribution in the society.
You see, your problem here is you haven't actually defined what socialism as an economic system is. So you're just coming out with this random bullshit about the state owns everything, and I don't know what you think socialism is, but I can tell you now it's wrong. Socialism is worker ownership of the means of production, not state ownership of the means of production. This is basic shit I've had to just explain to people since I've been fucking 16. You know, it's fucking ridiculous.
This redistribution of wealth is ultimately achieved by relinquishing control of the means of production to the state. This basically means that in a communist society, nobody can own any business. It means that nobody can produce anything that can be sold for profit because the state owns every means of production and is in charge of its distribution.
You're not explicitly restricted from owning a business under communism. It's a common misconception. The very concept of owning a business just doesn't make sense to begin with under communism. That's the thing. Now, are you freer under feudalism than capitalism because you're incapable of owning serfs? No, of course not. It just doesn't make sense in the capitalist system. You see, yeah, as I was talking about earlier, you're jumping around between these terms, socialism and communism, as if they're the same thing, but they're really not. And it's making someone like me with an actual nuanced idea of what socialism and communism is, finding it hard to figure out how to respond to your arguments because I don't even know what you're really trying to say. I mean, you know, are you talking about the transitionary period from capitalism to socialism with the central planning? In which case, you know, there's still technically capitalism and commodity production, so the concept of owning a business could theoretically still make sense, but because there's central planning, markets have been abolished. So again, it doesn't really, you know, it's just not something you can do. But it's not like you're going to have the KGB come around and, you know, throw you in the gulag if you try to make a lemonade stand. It's just that because markets have been abolished, it's just starting a business again. It's just, how would you do that even? Or do I want to deal with what you actually said, a communist society past that transitionary phase? Which by that point, again, the concept of a business still makes no sense, but for the reason that the very idea of markets makes no sense, or even central planning doesn't apply. The very way that goods are distributed under communism is just in such a radically different way to capitalism that this question of running and owning a business just isn't even one to be discussed. Like, this Marx quote gets across what I'm talking about here. So this is from Critique of the Gopher Program. Brilliant read, I strongly recommend it. Okay, so before I go into this, the means of consumption, that's just a fancy way of saying goods. But anyway, the distribution of the means of consumption at any time is only a consequence of the distribution of the conditions of production themselves. The latter distribution, however, is a feature of the mode of production itself. The capitalist mode of production, for example, rests on the fact that the material conditions of production are in the hands of the non-workers, that being, you know, the capitalists, in the form of property in capital and land, while the masses are only owners of personal conditions of production, vis-a-vis labor power. Once the elements of production are so distributed, then the present-day distribution of the means of consumption results automatically. If the material conditions of production are the cooperative property of the workers themselves, then this likewise results in a different distribution of the means of consumption from the present one. So literally all Marx is saying here is that the mode of production and the distribution of the means of consumption or the goods are intertwined, and that when you change the mode of production, that distribution automatically sorts itself out, as it has done in history every single time that the mode of production has been changed, be it from slavery to feudalism or feudalism to capitalism. So as you can see, it's actually really difficult to figure out what you're even attacking, because to you, everything is just kind of one big blob of leftism, instead of a nuanced view of transitionary phase, socialism, and communism. Shit, I've just realized that I've ranted on for an extremely long time and not even that far into the video, so we're just gonna skip over his terrible explanation of the history of communism, just skip to the actual points themselves.
So here are five reasons why communism, at the end of the day, proved to be a really, really dumb, stupid idea. Number one, forced collectivization.
Okay, so I'll make clear already, and even the Stalinists would agree with me here, that collectivization is not a feature of communism, but rather a context-dependent method used by Stalin to prepare feudal Russia to take the first steps towards socialism. You see, Russia wasn't even fully capitalist at the time of the Bolshevik Revolution, and capitalism and industry are a prerequisite to socialism. Henceforth, collectivization was just one of the methods that Stalin used to help prepare Russia to go towards socialism. The reason this is so important is he's trying to use it as a reason as to why communism doesn't work, yet collectivization, again, is just a method that was used one time for a specific country to prepare itself for socialism. You see, the very idea of using collectivization today makes literally no sense because we don't have feudal agrarian societies like we did back then. So it's not a feature of communism. The best you can do is argue that Stalin didn't do this like specific thing, right? And that he should have tried to prepare Russia for socialism in a different way. I'll let you argue that, but saying that this has anything to do with communism itself is well, shows no understanding, but I think it's been proven you have no understanding already.
Collectivization was an anti-private farming policy adopted by the USSR in an effort to facilitate the equitable distribution of agricultural produce, all while reducing the economic power of the kulaks, or the prosperous proletariat.
Prosperous proletariat? Not really. No, the kulaks were landowners. They weren't explicitly proletariat or bourgeoisie, though, because as I said, Russia was like semi-feudalist at this point, and the kulaks were a feudalist specific class. So to assign them specifically to either the proletariat or bourgeoisie just doesn't really make any sense.
The forced collectivization law was most intensely pursued between 1928 and 1940, which coincided with Stalin's rise to power. Following Marxist doctrines, the USSR believed that forced collectivization would maximize the agricultural resources in the countryside.
What Marxist doctrines? Show me them. Show me the specific Marxist doctrines that says, in Russia specifically, we need to do forced collectivization. I want to see that. You see, Marx never actually talked about this, which is why Stalin was at best applying Marx to a specific context. Although even that is debatable, really.
This led to tens of millions of people who starved to death. The state's reacquisition of private farms was largely paid for by the working class, some tens of millions of whom famished to death in the first 5 years of forced collectivization. Chinese farmers were met with the same fate in the 1960s, which left 33 million people starving to their deaths.
Now look, I'm no tanky, so I don't have the numbers and stats on me to refute a lot of these things about the deaths under Soviet regimes. However, it seems like you don't have any sources either, so I think we'll just leave it with this one Hitchens quote. I will make it clear just for anyone wondering, I did check his description to see if maybe he left something in there, but no, he's just saying this stuff with no... nothing.
Next, lack of basic human rights. Communism in theory is a philosophical imagining of a utopian society where citizens of the state are ultimately able to share resources and benefits according to need, where property serves as the common good for all. Communism in practice, however, has realized only authoritarian society so far.
Now this is blatant misinformation and just outright lying. And I've been holding off going into this for all the other times he's mentioned it, but now let's really get into it. Now, most of you may know that I've actually made an entire video going on all the times that socialism has been successfully implemented and it's been pretty good and it hasn't led to evil dictatorship or evil genocide or any of that stuff, okay? You probably don't know about most of these places because you never really taught about them in school, because where would you? But I think the best examples to use would be the Paris, German, and Hungarian communes, and also revolutionary Catalonia. And when I say Germany and Hungary, I'm not referring to Soviet Union, Germany and Hungary in like the mid-20th century. I'm talking about the start of the 20th century when they had their own separate revolutions, literally just after the Soviet Union had even become a thing. In fact, no, it wasn't even called the Soviet Union by the time these guys had their revolutions. And they set up their own communes, which lasted a while, but then kind of got crushed by fascism. We'll get into that. So these countries all established a dictatorship of the proletariat and worker ownership of the means of production, meaning that the workers themselves had full control over the state through recallable at any time representatives, which were at the mercy of the workers themselves. These representatives were paid workbound wages and also were chosen by the working class themselves. And in regards to the workplaces, it's kind of like co-ops we have today, but everywhere and not with markets and stuff. All the while, some of these places were fighting self-proclaimed, actual literal fascists. And you know, that's got to be a good thing. You can't say, I just know there's going to be one person who's like, oh, I prefer fascism to any kind of communism, and it's just, it hurts. Now, yes, these societies, for as great as they were, and for the accomplishments that they achieved, I mean, the Paris Commune in particular, first place to separate the church from the state, you know, and you know, a lot of nice worker rights that we enjoy today are actually the result of socialism, but that's a whole other topic. Yes, eventually these societies were crushed by either fascism or capitalist standing armies. However, that's not the point. Obviously, it's a problem that these things were crushed, and it's something that socialists need to look at. It's like, okay, so how do we not die in the future? Something worth thinking about. But the point that I'm trying to get across here is that the system itself has been shown to work. and not get corrupted. The inner workings of the system itself work perfectly fine until someone comes along and shoots everybody. But I wouldn't really call that inherent to socialism, because I feel like that's a bit more general to any political system.
The blatant disregard for fundamental civil rights is at the very heart of the collapse of the Marxist governments in former communist states.
And I really love how you bring up MLK here when he was a socialist.
Number 3, failure to adapt. Among the most prominent reasons why a Marxist setup of society tends to collapse upon itself is because of its inability to adapt to the changing conditions that exists outside of its prescribed reality.
What the fuck are you even talking about? What? You just... I don't even know where to begin with this, because you're just saying things for no reason now.
For instance, the fluctuation that occurs in a free market economy is a real-world riddle that Marxism economists were unable to solve.
Market fluctuations are something Marxists can't solve. Market fluctuations. Are you kidding me? Are you actually telling me that Marxism says that the prices of commodities are always constant? Kill yourself.
A Marxist approach to understanding the market fails to take into account the market prices of commodities. Without access to the checks and balances of the prices of commodities, it was unable to properly distribute its national resources.
Okay, so this is actually just a really stupid and dumb roundabout way of presenting the economic calculation problem. Now, I've made videos going over this before, so you can go watch them if you want. They're pretty good. But in short, the argument says that centrally planned economies, and that's not even socialism itself, that's the transitionary phase, but centrally planned economies can't determine what the correct prices of commodities should be in their society to like fit supply and demand and make it all efficient and all that stuff, right? The thing is though, this kind of, I mean, the reasons they give is that either, you know, because you don't have market signals or because you can't calculate the market fluctuations along the production line. This just doesn't make sense. You still have statistics for supply and demand. And you still have, well, now we have computers which can easily calculate all that shit. Again, if you want a much more detailed explanation, go watch those videos. In fact, I feel like I might even make a third video for that, because that quote, Marx quote I gave earlier, actually kind of completely destroys the economic calculation problem, because it says it's a problem of socialism, but even trying to apply market reasoning to socialism, as I explained earlier, just makes no sense. I'm getting off topic, let's continue.
Next, lack of creativity. A Marxist-informed state by design values utilitarianism over anything else.
No, it fucking doesn't. It just doesn't.
Marxist utilitarianism basically means that for every action performed by a citizen, there must be a resulting contribution to the empowerment of the state.
That's not even what utilitarianism is. Even on its own, that's not what it is. The state is not even involved.
Communist nations have little to no use for artistic endeavors such as the writing of literature, sculpture, and painting, among others.
Oh, and capitalism does it? You're the type of guy to tell me that capitalism allows the true expression of the arts, and then go and yell at some liberal for taking an arts degree and not being able to find a fucking job. Communism is the only system that allows for the true flourishment of the arts, because it is the only system where you do not need to labor to sustain your very existence, and you can actually focus on the arts and what you truly find passionate, and that is why it would be a much better society than what we have now.
And on the other hand, artists who oppose the Communist Party are perceived as threats and are immediately eliminated.
They're not. They're just not. This is beyond delusional by this point. You're just making shit up as you go along. Did you even have a script for this video? You're literally just pulling all this stuff out of your ass now. Like, you guys see why I didn't want to respond to this video now? It's such bullshit.
Finally, Marxism was a bad idea from the very start. A likely explanation to the failures of communism, both as an economic and political establishment, is that Karl Marx is basically a moron. Much of the economic philosophies of Marxism are deeply rooted in the labor theory of value. It asserts that, for example, a car should cost more than a pair of sneakers, simply because more labor was necessary in the production of a car than a pair of sneakers. While that equation might sound reasonable on the surface, it is too overly simplified.
You hear that, guys? the labor theory of value is actually really oversimplified. I mean, Capital is only over 2,000 pages long. That's nothing.
For example, let's take that iPhone you all have. There are other cell phones out there that pretty much match the performance in every single specification of the more popular iPhone, yet the iPhone retails for twice as much. I mean, the cost of materials and labor between the two phones are pretty similar, yet people gladly pay twice as much for an iPhone. The same is true for medicine and with almost every commodity in the market.
Okay, so the thing here is that the labor theory of value deals with the cost of production and how that relates to the actual kind of like inert value that something has in the marketplace. Not what people are willing to pay for it, but how much it actually takes to produce something and continually produce something. Now, using the labor theory of value, you can accurately describe the cost of production for an iPhone or any smartphone and how that relates to the labor time that's gone into it. However, we're dealing with the basics of the labor theory of value, and in fact, throughout the entirety of Capital Volume 1, Marx takes the assumption that supply and demand are at equilibrium, just because it makes life a bit easier to explain, and again, you're mainly dealing with production and not the actual selling, so it's just not really related. Of course, then later he does explain how things fit in his theory when supply and demand aren't at equilibrium. But that's why on the face of it, when you deal with essentially racketeered markets like the medicine industry or diamonds or the artificial scarcity there or artificial demand racked up through advertisement campaigns, with iPhones, that's why it doesn't directly correspond to the labor time or the exchange value, that kind of inert value that is given to it by the labor time that's gone into it when being sold on the market. So the actual true kind of cost of production value that it has is generally what commodities are sold for. It's just that when you get these kind of like specific instances of market manipulation, then it changes and super profits can be made. But that's kind of, that's another topic. Yeah, there are exceptions to this rule that things are sold at the cost of production, but if everything or even the majority of things weren't sold at the cost of production, for every gain that you'd make in overselling something would be a loss somewhere else when you buy something, so it would equal out aggregate. So again, yeah, there are exceptions to this rule, but there are explanations why that is as well.
Because real world economy dictates that the price of a product is motivated by its supply and demand.
Now you seem to imply that the labor theory of value just doesn't take supply and demand into account or something, but you see, in one of these books that I happen to have on hand, there is an entire, like, in one of Marx's works, Value, Price, and Profit, which is also another great book, strongly recommend it, there is an entire chapter called Supply and Demand, where he goes in and explains how supply and demand works and how it relates to labor theory of value. We are aware of the real world, you know. Give us some credit.
But to Marx, he saw communism as the final evolution of social progression. He believed that the world was bound to evolve from primitive civilizations to masters and slave societies to feudal kingdoms to capitalist countries to socialist nations until eventually to a singular egalitarian communist utopia. But there exists a larger world outside Karl Marx's mind, a world that might not be a utopia in any shape or form, but a much real world nonetheless, peopled by those who live through real world abuses driven by political and economic inequality.
Now, none of this last point makes any sense at all, because he sets up the premise and then just ends it with, but what about the real world? And that's just not an argument. Whatever, this video was cancer, honestly. I'm not taking recommendations from you guys again on what to respond to, because none of you have any fucking taste. But nonetheless, I do hope you enjoyed the video, and I do hope you remember to like and subscribe and do all the stuff that you normally do, and leave a comment telling me how much you loved it or hated it if you want. And donate to my Patreon while you're at it, maybe. Just you know. I found out today that USB mics are totally shit and worthless, which, thinking about it, actually does make a lot of sense. But what really confuses me is that all the top YouTubers still use the Blue Yeti, but actually the Blue Yeti is shit, which is nice for me to know now, because I was actually thinking of buying one at some point. But now I'm looking into a much more expensive setup, like double the price of the Blue Yeti, so I need those Patreon bucks to get it. Now, I'm actually going to be working in about a month, so maybe I'll just spend the money from that as well. But anyways, yeah, I'm ranting. I do hope you guys enjoyed the video. Again, do make sure you like and comment and stuff, because that just helps the video grow and get me all those views, because I'm a view whore, so that's important to me. But nonetheless, I'll see you guys next time.